graduate program. I'd like to welcome you all. We have the School of Arts and Science who supported this, in cooperation with the new Center for Research and Practice, who is generously helping us to live stream the proceedings on the internet. For anyone who wants to watch the live stream, or if you have friends who are interested from anywhere around the world, you can see this these proceedings live at the new Center website. And that's the New Center for Research and Practice. So just a few words about Fernando Zalamea, who will be speaking for this lecture series for the next six sessions, and then our final roundtable session for the entire month of October. We are thrilled to have Fernando here. In many senses, I think it's not a stretch to say that he's one of the foremost philosophers of mathematics working today in the continental tradition, and trying to transform philosophy and mathematics in general from something which is dominated by analytic philosophy and the reductionism of set theory into something that speaks to what Fernando calls real mathematics, working mathematics, the sort of mathematics that mathematicians work with on a daily basis that is not reduced to the sort of modernist notions where the abstract and universal reduce everything to the elementary, but rather a mathematics of transits, mathematics of the transvisual, to take a term from Felix Guattari, a mathematics that is open to the local and the creative potential of the local to manifest things that the universal is often blind to, and it's abstract hegemony. And for Fernando, this is not merely a philosophy of mathematics, although clearly it is a powerful philosophy of mathematics, but it is also a philosophy of why mathematics as a discourse, as a symbolic practice, as a practice of invention and discovery, is able to be a paradigmatic beacon to re-understand many contemporary impasses in culture and society. Fernando is someone who has published over 20 books in Spanish on a huge variety of topics, while his PhD is in mathematics, and that is from the University of Massachusetts at Amherst. He also has two master's degrees, one in pure mathematics from the University of Paris 6, and another master's degree from the University of Massachusetts Amherst. But his works have not been limited to mathematics, even though that is an incredibly rich and profound discipline, as I think we're all aware. He's someone who has published on Valéry, someone who has published on painting, on networks, on architecture, on urban design, on Warburg, on Florensky, on Merleau-Ponty. He's someone who's at home with Whitehead and Leibniz, as he is with works of music, and he's a social critic, most particularly on the particular case of America in relation to the transvisual. And this will be the subject of a new text which will soon be published by Ergonomic in translation in English. But he's someone who's worked at the boundaries between mathematical discipline and a huge variety of other disciplines, from social critique, artistic, and aesthetic work, to urban planning and social and political issues. He's most known in the English-speaking world for three books which have been published only in the last few years, and this has gotten him an enormous amount of acclaim for his work almost overnight. The first of these in 2011 was an introductory essay, an extremely developed introductory essay, in the collected works that were published in English the first time, of Albert Laudmann, the French philosopher of mathematics from the 1930s. Well, his work mostly concentrated in the 1930s because he was killed during the Second World War. After this, same year actually, 2011, Professor Zalamea published in English his work on Peirce's Logic of Continuity, a seminal book that shows the way in which Peirce functions as a paradigmatic case for Fernando, and as a beacon for contemporary mathematical thought, but also contemporary social and political thinking in general. And then in 2012, with Urbanomic and Sequence Press, Fernando published an incredibly voluminous, detailed, careful, difficult, and amazing book, which I think is in many senses a masterwork. This is the synthetic philosophy of contemporary mathematics. So it is with great pleasure that I would like to introduce for his talk series, Grothendieck and the Theory of Contemporary Transgression, Professor Fernando Zalamea. Thank you.
Thank thank you very much, Chris, for this incredibly generous and liar, beautiful lies that you are talking about me. Very generous, and thank you very much for the organization, this opportunity to be with you and to think about a theory which is like in the moment of development. We will talk in six lectures around Grothendieck and the theory of contemporary transgression. The four words are important. Grothendieck is our center for these lectures, for these sessions. It's probably the greatest mathematician of the 20th century. I will explain a little why he's so important, and we will profit from.
Just we can hear you a little better.
Okay. We will profit then from Grothendieck in order to do a theory, a general theory of the understanding of concepts in general. Don't worry about so much mathematics. I know that I will be in very dangerous grounds because for the mathematicians, the things that I will say I will be more or less stupid, and for the people in cultural studies, what I will say will be more or less stupid. So. I am in dangerous grounds in both of them, but I will try nevertheless to say one or two things which are interesting, thanks to God. The contemporary means essentially from 1950 to today, Grothendieck's work were done in the main important ideas by Grothendieck were done between 1950 and 1970. And the applications to modern to contemporary mathematics are all along developing since that time. He will probably be the mathematician, the greatest mathematician for the 21st century. And we will talk a lot about transgression, about transits. How can we transgress our disciplines? How can we go beyond our usual well-rounded walls? How can we translate that? How we can can we produce a theory of transits in general? Those transits will come from Grothendieck's mathematics, but I will apply them in general to the cultural problems. This is the outline of my talks. I excused already myself for my horrible accent, but there is nothing I can do about that. And the slides will be, I hope, better and written than what I can speak. And the slides will be available after each session. After today, the PDF of my talks today will be available at the web. Chris Vital is going to, do that for us. And that's after each session. So today I will be speaking about the main conceptual mathematical ideas of Grothendieck, in understanding mathematics as a conceptual way of thinking. You will never see in my lectures a formula or more very technical mathematics, but I will be speaking as far as I can from a conceptual point of view, in which the concepts come from mathematics, but can and should be applied to culture in general. So today I will be focusing on Grothendieck mathematics. Tomorrow, this Grothendieck mathematics will be a little further explored from a philosophical point of view, and I will get some general philosophical ideas, groundbreaking philosophical ideas which are changing a little our world, coming from Grothendieck. And afterwards, the main part of the talks will be the next 2 weeks after this one, in which I will try to apply this, this conceptual mathematics, this philosophical ground ideas to complete cases in our contemporary world. Coming from the idea that many of the important tensions that we are living today can be traced back at least to a very giant, important personality for me and so I think for all modernity, which is Novalis, the great thinker and poet, German poet, which has a lot of extraordinary and wonderful talks about transits, about the non-separation of disciplines, about how the plasticity of the poet and the exactitude of the mathematician, but you say back and forth, a class which is very important for our understanding of how things work in the world. And I will have then Novalis as the grounding father of a lot of problems of today, which can be reflected today in several very interesting works which are done by the younger people by Collapse, this philosophical journal of the British youngest minds. I will talk about Collapse and how the ideas of Collapse can be related to some important problems in the going back and forth between the local and the global in general. We will talk about networkologies, one of the main works of Christopher Vitale, our host here, and how these networks are reflecting very important problems which came from Novalis, and this back and forth between the grounding father Novalis and what is happening today with young movements, collapse, ecologies. The topos of music is not done by a young person, but a very young mind. Guarino Mazzola is very established, very well important, very important theoretician of music, but his mind is incredibly young. And so I will put him with the youngest there, with collapse, natural qualities. And with Glassbed, it's a movement of French and British young artists which are trying to do like a new theory of art as a center for transits in the contemporary world. The Atlas of Transformation is a wonderful, wonderful work of the Czech school. I will use the Atlas of Transformation also to have like a backbone. We will have the backbone of Novalis, the backbone of the Atlas of Transformation, and between them, we will go back and forth going through problems in which Grothendieck can explain better and can help to theorize better a lot of the issues which in principle are scattered. They are scattered everywhere. If you see all the names here and all the different possibilities, you see that they are here or there in art, in music, in literature, in philosophy, mathematics. But I think we can mix them together in some way with good theoretical, with a good theoretical framework, which is the Grothendieck framework. It's like trying to do for the contemporary world something similar which could have been done with great philosophers like Plato or Leibniz in the moment, which were very good mathematicians also, very well informed about mathematics, and that good information about mathematics was very helpful for them to produce a general philosophical framework. I think that this can be done with Grothendieck now. At the end, as Chris was telling, we will be together, the main persons that I will be studying in the next 2 weeks, the people from Collapse, Rezane Garestani and Robin McKay, Christopher Vitale from Anthropologies, Guarino Mazzola from the Topos of Music, and Fabien Ciego of Gasbel will all be here for a final round table where all this should come together in a dialogue. Today perhaps since it's the first talk, I will go a little further than expected in time. Usually the organizations of the talks will be very open in order that we have a discussion afterwards. I want to, in general, to have 90 minutes of talking, perhaps less, if I can, and then we can talk, we can have questions and answers, which would be the most interesting part, perhaps, after I give the basic information. Today, since I am introducing Grothendieck, perhaps I will take a little longer, and there will be more information than usual. Also, in the slides that you are going to see, there is a lot of information. I will not be talking about the lot of information that is in the slides. I wrote them carefully in order that you can study them afterwards, or you can read them, and then you have questions. You can have questions on me on the next session and things like that. That we can begin a dialogue. So that's the general idea. We will use conceptual mathematics, not technical mathematics, not formulas, conceptual mathematics as a tool to have a general view, which you don't usually have if you don't have mathematics. If you don't have mathematics, you cannot get to that conceptual general view, I think so, because you have to learn a little about Grothendieck. So Grothendieck will give this general perspective, and with this general perspective, we will come back to particular local studies. So, Grothendieck, this is my outline for today. I will be talking quickly about the place of Grothendieck, in why Grothendieck is important, who was he, and I will mainly focus on the four greatest innovations by Grothendieck. He was a genius, a mathematical genius, and he invented a lot of new mathematics. I will focus on four things which are central for him and which are central for the development of mathematics after Grothendieck, going very synthetically on them. Each of these topics, if you study them carefully, should take at least a semester if you are serious enough. I will synthesize one semester in 15 minutes. So you can see that probably we are in very dangerous grounds. But I will try to do my best to do the synthesis. And then we can talk, and these things will develop along the seminar, along October. Today I will be putting in the map the main mathematical ideas. But those main mathematical ideas, I will develop them afterwards also when I will apply them to what the other story. Don't worry, extremely free. Yes, please.
If I understand correctly, you'll share the slides?
Yes. The slides will be shared after every session. And this night, we have a web page. The information is in the flyer. In that web page, you will have the slides every night after I talk. So you will have the slides of my first talk today, but of the second tomorrow, and this way you will be. So they will be available. So the four main ideas by Grothendieck are what we will call it sheaves, schemes, topos, and models. I will explain everything. I will try to explain everything from a conceptual point of view. Don't worry. Okay. This is the outline of my talk today. So who was Grothendieck? Grothendieck as a person was a very strange and beautiful person. He had fathers which were very, very interesting people, anarchists from Eastern Europe. His father was a revolutionary by profession. He went on all the anarchist movements in Europe in the beginning of the 20th century. And Alexander Grothendieck, is the name of our mathematician, was very proud that his father was twice put on death row. First by the Tsar, and then by the Bolsheviks. he was very happy that his father had this power to be against all kinds of powers. He was a very active person, and this active personality was also like very influential, very had some influence on Alexander the mathematician. He was born in Germany, but he stayed a little time in Germany. He always had a double or triple fourth personality with many times, many different languages. He lived mainly all of his mathematical life in France, but he was used to teach mathematics in German and then to translate them. He was a very polyphasetic person, with many words at the same time. He had a very beautiful young life in 5 years with his parents. Then his parents went away to the Spanish Civil War, and they left him with one Lutheran father near Hamburg, and he stayed there until 10 years more or less. And he reunited with his parents after the Spanish Civil War finished in 1939. He was born in 1928. In 1939, he reunited with his father, but they are sent to prisoner camps, to concentration camps in France. So Alexander stayed 2 years in a concentration camp with his mother. His father was sent to Auschwitz soon, and he was killed in Auschwitz. With his mother, he survived at the camps. Alexander and his mother survived to the camps, and he began to study mathematics more or less on his own. He did his studies of mathematics in Montpellier, a little city of France, of province France, all by himself. And he reinvented something very important in mathematics, which is called the Beck theory, the measure theory. He invented only by himself, not looking at books. It was a way of doing mathematics, which was very important for him. Do mathematics, do not read mathematics, do mathematics. Pose your problems and develop your problems yourself. And then this will bring you to the deep and profound questions. Instead, if you read too much things around, perhaps you will not be so original. He was consistent in that way. He always did his mathematics independently of what happened around him. So in 1948, he finished his mathematics career in Montpellier, having reinvented the Lebesgue theory, which mathematically is something incredible, very, very important. And he went to Paris for the first time in 1949, and then he united the seminaire at the École Normale Supérieure de Henri Cartan, one of the great mathematicians of the 50s. And here, and that seminar, he understood for the first time the mathematics that were done around him. Until that moment, he thought more or less, he was very naive, very ingenious, and that's one of his strengths, one of his forces. He thought that he was more or less the only mathematician in the world. And then he arrives to Paris, and he sees the very, very important people around Cartan, which were the brightest young minds in mathematics in that time, around the group at Hilo. Very important people. And he began to learn very quickly all the mathematical tools that were available at that time. He didn't know at that time what was a topological space. For those who know a little mathematics, that's incredible that Grothendieck at age 20, didn't know what was a topological space or what was a group. But in 1 year, he mastered already all the mathematics, and he began to be one of the greatest mathematicians of that moment. In 1951, he goes to Nancy, which is also a small French city. But in that small French city, mathematics were going to blossom a lot around Didonné and Schwartz. Johann Schwartz was a field medalist already in 1950, and in Grothendieck begins to work with Schwartz, and he solves a lot of very important and difficult problems that Schwartz wasn't able to solve, and that he gave to the young brilliant mind to see what happened. Those were 14 horribly difficult open problems, and Grothendieck solved 7 of those problems in 1 semester and the other 7 in another year. Something which is completely out of the norm, even for the brightest mathematician. So he was a very talented and special person. Afterwards, he went to other margins. Nancy is like a margin of mathematics. He went to Sao Paulo, he went to Kansas. There he did a lot of very important mathematics that I am going to talk about. And afterwards, in Paris, he came back to Paris, and a very important institution was open to him. The Institute, the Objective the Scientific, was open for him and for Dieudonné, in order that they have the possibility to create a new school of mathematics. They did so, and it was a decade absolutely extraordinary in Paris in mathematics. Between 1960 and 1970, they changed really a lot of the more important ideas of mathematics. Afterwards, he was a very straightforward person, a person who never tried to do something which was wrong. His ethics was very strong, and he knew that the Institute, the Institute Scientific, was in part funded by military funds. So he did leave the Institute, and he lived the community, the mathematical community. He was at that moment just 42 years of age, and he was clearly the greatest mathematician of that time. He abandoned the mathematical community and went to do his mathematics away. He never stopped doing mathematics, but he did not show in the community. He died last year, and probably you have heard about that in the papers. From 1990 to last year, he was secluded in a small village in the Pyrenees in France. Very few people knew about him and what he was living. He had one or two friends. His family was away. But then it seems that at the moment, the persons who are taking the care of it seems that he left at least 50,000 pages of unpublished manuscripts, which is something completely crazy. Also, the quantity and the volume of his work. The quality is completely outstanding, as we will see later. But the quantity also is fantastic. Published in the English, 20,000 pages of great mathematics. But it seems that we have the future has. The future has 50,000 pages of wonderful mathematics and wonderful reflections of Grothendieck that would be very important for this century. Here are some of his pictures when he was very young at 5, and then when he was playing piano. In one moment, he was so fond of the piano that he didn't know if he wanted to do mathematics or to be a pianist. There, he was also of very limited economical means. He worked in the fields as a laborer. In the second row, you have Grothendieck in 51 at Nancy when he's doing his PhD. Then in 55 at Kansas when he wrote writes one of the greatest papers of the 20th century in mathematics, the Tohoku. I will talk about that. And in the third, in the second row, in the third place, you have Grothendieck at the height of his power at the Institute of Obstruction. And the bottom row at left, you have Grothendieck at the seminaire. The seminaire Grothendieck, the geometria at the Institute. Was like the mecca of mathematics at the time. In 1970, he is resigning from mathematics at the Nice Congress, and then you have Grothendieck at age 60, one of his last photographs. The work is something gigantic. We will not go over this. These are information that you get in the slides, in the PDF, if you want to go to the details afterwards. Those make a lot of very important mathematical ideas. I will begin with this basic slide, which is a very important tension in mathematics between arithmetic and geometry. At the upper side, you have arithmetic, the study of numbers, geometry, the study of space. And in the middle, you have like two very important tools to understand that basic thing. We can see that probably in mathematics, we will work about in all these sessions about a very, very important fundamental tension, which is number versus magnitude, discrete versus continuous. This is the main basic tension. How you understand the discrete to the continuous and continuous to the discrete, there is a tension. It's a back and forth, more like also a dialectic. So for those who know a little mathematics, a Galois connection or an adjunction. There is tension, a very fundamental tension between number and magnitude in mathematics. And the understanding of that tension has given rise to one of many of the most important constructions in mathematics since the middle of the 19th century to today. We will talk about a little about them. The two important names for us now and along these talks are Galois and Riemann. Évariste Galois, a very young, bright, very important mathematician from 1811 to 1830, died very young. He worked about algebraic equations. I will explain very briefly the main key ideas. There is something which I want to say explicitly. Or the main important ideas in mathematics are and should be simple. If they are not simple enough, it's because I am not telling them right, I am not explaining me right, but the main ideas are very simple, very, very simple, and very strong. Since they are simple, they are deep. This is the main idea. Grothendieck insisted very much on that. Grothendieck insisted that the main ideas in mathematics is like a game for children, a children's game. It should be simple. Conceptually, it should be very simple. So this is the Galois idea, which is very simple and very strong. You have equations, algebraic equations. So you have an algebraic equation in the ordinary sense. And you want to solve the equation. The algebraic equation is in one level. And then you try to solve the equation. That gives you some solutions. The solutions don't live in the same level. You have one solution over here, one solution over there, one solution over there. You put all the solutions together. The solutions are seen from the ground. They are invisible from the ground. How do you go from one solution to the other? You go to transformations. It's the first appearance of transits. Transits will be everywhere in my talks and everywhere in mathematics. So take them with the simplest idea. Algebraic equations, solutions to the algebraic equations, how do you transit between them? How do you go from one to the other? You take all the transit between them, it is called the Galois group. Very, very simple idea, extremely simple idea. That Galois group will tell you when you can solve or not solve the equation. That's it. It's a very simple idea, very profound idea. And the idea is the following one, which will be very interesting for us from a philosophical standpoint afterwards. you have the back equation on one level. The solutions are on another level. They cannot be seen from the level, from the underground level. They are invisible. The transits between the visibility is by definition the Galois group. And the Galois group will tell you when you can solve. So to solve, to render visible our object, you go through the invisible. And you define the transits between invisibility and the Galois group. First, great idea, Galois. Second, great idea, really. It's also something similar. You don't take now algebraic equations, you take differential equations. You have differences. You have continuity. In the algebraic equations, you weigh the discrete world. Now you take the opposite, the continuous world. In the continuity world, you have differential equations. And you try to solve them. You try to solve the differential equations. So Riemann introduced the basic continuity concept, which can solve some obstructions of invisibility. The obstruction of invisibility is exactly this one. You have, instead of the usual numbers, real numbers, you can have imaginary numbers. That's very certain about them. All the mathematicians will say to me, he's saying stupid things. This is what I am aware about that. But so you have the real world, and then you have an imaginary world. You take the complex numbers, and then you take the transformation between the complex numbers. There is one which is more important than that, and all of the different transformations with the exponential. You take C and the exponential of C. When you take the exponential between this complex numbers and the complex numbers, every strip, there are a lot of strips in the complex numbers which repeat themselves. You take one strip, and that strip covers by the exponential the whole complex plane except zero. And there you take another strip, and it recovers also the complex plane except zero. And that for every strip, 2π on the complex plane. So what you have, follow the mathematics, don't worry. What you have is a very simple idea. You have how to transform, but here you have a multiplicity which is repeated at right. So you have the multiple and the one. What is the Riemann idea? The Riemann idea is that you have there a coming back of invisibility. All the differences here are invisible here. How do you get the invisibility visible? You take copies of the complex plane, you develop them on a layer, on an infinite layer, and you glue them all at zero. So what was multiple and one comes multiple and multiple, and then you can have a back and forth without any problems. That's what is called the Riemann surface. So the Galois group and the Riemann surface are perhaps the two greatest ideas of the beginning of the 19th century. Yes,
the Galois what?
Galois group. Group. G-R-O-U-P. Group. Thanks. Please do what your colleague is doing all the time. You can question me in any time, please. You are here for that. So, Galois group. How to render visible the invisibility of algebraic transformations, the Riemann surface, how to render visible the invisibility of analytic transformations. More simple, it's impossible. It's very, very simple. It's a very simple idea. The technical details and the calculations are long, but the idea is very simple. So Grothendieck will be working on that tradition all the time. He will be working on the tradition of Galois and Riemann. Trying to do something which seems almost impossible. If you haven't heard these things, it will seem to be impossible. You heard them, you have heard them in the beginning. Repeated, but number, magnitude, the number, the discrete, the magnitude, the continuous, they seem to be very far apart. There is a very simple, very great, profound idea by Grothendieck. You take seriously Galois, take seriously Riemann, you unite them together in something which will be more abstract and which will project both in number and both in magnitude. So number and magnitude will be special cases of something more general, of something more profound in mathematics, something more archetypical. The archetype of mathematical thought is somewhere here. It will be projected in number, in magnitude, it will be projected in algebra, in continuity. Grothendieck did that. He discovered that such an archetype exists. That is very, very important. The influence of Grothendieck is there drawn. This is the panorama of the Fields Medals in mathematics after Grothendieck. A lot of the main important field medalists come from Grothendieck, which shows his influence, gigantic influence in mathematics. This is half of the way of the field medalists after Grothendieck. Many of them are solving important Grothendieck problems. The Fields Medals, you have heard probably that they are like the Nobel Prizes in mathematics. That's completely untrue. It's exactly the opposite. The Fields Medalists are prizes very important done to young mathematicians, which are inventing mathematics at the time. The Fields Medalists obtain their prizes when they are younger than 40 years. The Nobel Prizes is exactly the opposite. Get the Nobel Prize when you are very, very old and you did your work 50 years before. The Fields Medalists are like the most important expression of creativity. Grothendieck was a Fields Medalist. There are a lot of young, very young, important mathematicians who came after him, and which can be said part of his school. This shows that Grothendieck is well alive. That's not surprising for us mathematicians. But since some of you perhaps never heard about Grothendieck, it's important to know that we are in the moment, we are in a moment in which we are very fortunate. We have the work of a gigantic mathematician which has transformed completely mathematics and which will, in question of time, not very much time, which we mean, which we transform also our way of thought. It's late or time is deep in the moment. There are some important methodological strategies of Grothendieck that will be like key for us, key methodological strategies for us, which because they can be used to be applied to cultural problems. I will expand this slide a lot talk tomorrow. My talk of tomorrow is basically to expand this slide to an hour. But I want to explain briefly some of the basic strategies. One of the basic strategies is this one. You have an object, a mathematical object here, somewhere. Whatever it is, the object. Usually, and there has been an analytical tradition to understand the object, if you decompose it and you look at its elements, its layers, its differences inside. It's the analytical tradition of understanding an object in mathematics. There is an opposite strategy, not to understand the object, decomposing it, but composing it with all the objects similar to him around. It's a synthetical strategy in which the object is understood by the relationships with the context. So look inside or you look outside, the internal or the external. So a methodological strategy of Grothendieck, and which was always systematic in him, is to understand an object, take the class of all the objects similar to him, that is called the category. Take the category of all objects similar to him. And in that category, if you understand that category, then you understand the object. So that's it's a change of view, it's a paradigmatic change of view with very strong consequences. Very, very strong consequences. Mathematical, technically, but also methodologically. Afterwards. So this will be changed a lot. Think about categories. Think about categories, think synthetically, go from the one to the multiple. Multiply the object. So the thing in itself disappears, the Kantian thing in itself disappears, and we begin to think about the thing in context, the thing in otherness, not the thing in itself, but the thing in the other. So this is very important for our culture, of course. But mathematically, it gives a lot of very interesting technical tools. And if we do the work to go from the technical to the conceptual, and then project from the conceptual back to the original problem, we will get usually a new point of view. That's the idea. That's the first change. The second change is this one, which is also very interesting and very, very Grothendieckian. You have a lot of differences in the world. We are all the time inserted in all our differences, and we are extremely proud of that, of those differences. We are happy. But in fact, all those differences, usually in mathematics, are purely apparent. Between a lot of types, we will call that types, the differences. Between the types, usually there is something bigger, something more profound, something deeper, which we will call the archetype, which projects into the diverse types. So if our world is a world of a lot of differences, of walls. If you have a wall here, you cannot see the other one around. But if you go a little further, then you can see both people at the same time. And you can like produce in the abstract world some smoothness. This is a very important Grothendieckian idea. The types are essentially artificial, and the differences are artificial, are only apparent. If you go behind that, the archetype, then things are smooth. Things can be connected. Well, here you cannot see connections. Here things can be connected. And then you can project them back. This going to the abstract and projecting to the concrete, to the particular, will be a constant going back and forth, which will be very Grothendieckian. To go beyond the difference, go to the abstract, connect, and produce a smooth understanding in the abstract, and then project back. This is a Grothendieckian idea, which is very interesting. Also, which is very platonic, also. But here we will have a lot of technical tools that play to this. And a third general, very interesting idea is that in Grothendieck, there is a trend to produce non-separated thoughts. Our thoughts are usually very separated. We separate numbers from infinitesimals, from limits. We separate music from art, from philosophy. We are all the time separating things. And by essence, the analytical way of thought is very interesting. Has a lot of limitations also. The analytic, any analytic, by definition, any analytic perspective will get differences. We'll get differences. We'll get how to one object with the other, to their differences. Instead of that, if you try to go beyond that and go a little abstract and their objects are non-separated, then you can get some continuity that here you don't have. So the emergence or the apparition of non-separated objects in mathematics is not clear at all. Because if we will say, if we will put together, we will set in the traditional understanding of mathematics of the 20th century, it's organized around set theory. Remember, you have points in sets. You have a set, you decompose the set in points. The points are the elements. And then the idea is that you, if you know the elements, then you know the set. But if you remember, or if you can see simply with my hands, if you have a point between the point and the nothingness, there is nothing. That's one of the expectations of the analytic method or the atomistic method. If you have an atom, between the atom and the nothingness, there is nothing in between. That's one of the hopes of the theory. So points usually are separated. You have one point, another point. And in classical mathematics, you can get a neighborhood around the point here and another neighborhood around the point, which are disjoint. That is called the Hausdorff property of separation in mathematics. Usually, the spaces of classical mathematics are Hausdorff, are separated. Grothendieck invented and discovered non-separated objects in mathematics, which are very interesting for us, for our moment of development of the culture, when the culture is looking for non-separation trends. I will expand on this a lot. Let me go to the four main ideas. The first one comes from 19th century again. From something which is called the analytic continuation in mathematics. And which is also a very simple idea. If you have one part of the world here, and another part of the world, and another part of the world, and you can extend the information all around, every time that you can get the information, extend the information, you are amplifying the mathematical object. And then you are getting more and more information about mathematics. So, one natural trend in mathematics is to amplify, to extend a domain of definition. How to extend the domain of definition? You can do that by the drawing the left, which is called the analytic continuation in the complex variable, or you can do that going from local information. Here you have a local information, here you have another local information, another local, another local. And yet you try to go from the local to the local. Glue all together. Can you glue all together all the local information or not? Sometimes you can, sometimes you cannot. Depends. Of course, it depends on the properties of the object that you are trying to amplify. It depends on the topological properties of the context where you are going to work. Topology. What is topology? Topology, you know all well about that, but in any case, I want to try to be, for the non-mathematicians, to have all the conceptual ideas from the very beginning. What is a topological space? Something extremely simple. It's the space in which you can talk about continuity. That's it. Topological space is a space where you can talk about continuous content. So, you can extend going from the local to the global through continuous trends if the topological context is good enough. You can extend from the local to the global. Sometimes you can, sometimes you can. You can now extend that idea, which is the analytic continuation of the complex variable of 19th century, with Riemann again. Basic idea of Riemann, to what will be for us, and this is important, so please ask questions, or we will come back several times on this, etc. To the main concept on the main object for all our talks and all of Grothendieck ideas in mathematics and all the applications that we will have on culture, etc., which is the idea of sheaves. What is a sheaf? A sheaf is an extremely simple, again, very, very simple idea. Let's try to get it as very simple. What is very simple? The sheaf will be the simplest mathematical object to go from the local to the global. That's it. When you can go from the local to the global, you must have then two ranges when you can talk about locality, and one range where you can talk about globality. So the range, the bottom range will be a topological space. The upper range will be also topological space. And between two topological spaces, you will have a projection going from the biggest one to the smallest one, and the section going from the smallest one to the bigger one. Yes, please.
Can you define the local a little bit more?
We will be doing that later, but the idea is this one. The local will be the information on the bottom, and the global will be the information on the top. Okay. From local to global, going back and forth. Here in these pictures, you will have here like a small neighborhood around the point. This will be the local information. This local information goes here, and when you can glue together all the local information, you can go to the global. Thanks. But I think I will begin with a very simple example, very familiar for all of you. Yesterday we were walking with my wife around the High Line. You have walked around the High Line a lot of times. The High Line is a sheaf. The High Line is a sheaf in this sense, very simple sense. And this is a very beautiful example that we will have to. We will profit from that example a lot of times around in this topic. What is the High Line? You have the Manhattan grid, the simple grid by streets and avenues, the Cartesian grid here, and the High Line goes over that, trying to produce some continuity here, where here you don't have continuity. From the 13th to the 14th street, you have a block which you cannot traverse the block. You have some structure. You go to the High Line, then you get some continuity over there. And then you have some possibility of transits in the High Line that you don't have on the bottom grid of the Manhattan Cartesian grid. Streets, avenues on the bottom, something very, very simple and I would say almost trivial here, but instead the High Line is not at all trivial. The High Line is very, very beautiful. It between the Manhattan grid and the High Line, you have stairs, you have lifts, you have ramps, which are sections there from bottom to up. And then when you are in the High Line, you have a lot of overlooks, new paths, and new trends that you didn't have here. Is it possible to have on the High Line a global section? If you are in the High Line, say at 14th Street, it is certain that you will not see the global section there. You will only see parts and fragments of the continuity shift there. But if you go to one of the great buildings which are around, then you will be projecting the diverse sections, and then you will be gluing them together. This is an example that we will profit several times. You have here the trivial Manhattan grid, and here you have the High Line. The High Line will help to produce oneness, some globality, some transits, some global.
perspectives. Of course, this came from mathematics, yes.
I had a question. I guess you were saying the archetype projects into multiple objects.
Yes.
And these sort of differences. And the sheaf is able to kind of look at these various local differences and then glue them together into a unified structure. But the sheaf is reading between the analytic and the other diagram you have here. But I'm wondering if it's necessary to have both the projection, the view on the level of the projection, and also view from the global model. I mean, there's no priority of one.
No. That's good. That's very important. There is no priority. And in fact, afterwards, we will come back to, later in this talk. What is important will be not only to work with one sheaf, but with all, with the completion of all sheaves. Not with one object, but with all the objects. And there you can axiomatize, and there there is no priority. You can go from the global to the local. That's a very interesting question, also for the so this came from mathematics, the notion of shift, yes?
Yeah, I had a question. When you speak of local and global, if I'm understanding correctly, the global is not the absolute or the universal.
No.
It's also something that is in way local. It's the global to a particular locality.
Completely right. Something which disappeared completely in mathematics after Deleuze was the absolute. After 1930, you cannot speak about absolute proofs in mathematics. All the proofs are relative. We will be coming to that afterwards, also, which is very interesting. But so, the right here is like oneness in one context, in a given context. You can change the context, and then you will have different notions of global. Another question afterwards will be, can we glue different global perspectives? We will come to that. So this comes from mathematics in the 1950s. The sheaves were invented by the French school, and the Seminaire de l'Economie Supérieure, where Pratt was coming, where Grothendieck was coming in the and I will try to simplify. All of these slides have a lot of improvement. I will try to.
I'm really sorry. I have to take a little bit of issue with your metaphor, right?
Okay.
So, you know, when you think of local information on, you know, on some mathematical object, right? You have some kind of you have some kind of structure where you have something like an open set, or you know, something that gives you a notion of a particular point. You have some kind of like neighborhood.
Yes.
And global information has nothing to do with any external structure, right? Global information is about that object itself. Right, you know, you have something like a manifold or like a, you know, like a group or a ring or something. Global information is about the whole manifold or the whole group or the whole ring, right? And, you know, local information is on each chunk. And so, right, so I feel like, you know, your metaphor of like the high line sitting on top of the grid doesn't necessarily make sense, right? It's really more like you have, you know, like if you look at a map of Brooklyn, right, you can see that people try to locally impose different grids on different chunks.
Yes.
And then, right, so, but they don't necessarily meet in any reasonable way. And so, you know, a global system of coordinates, right, would be a grid that works and smoothly meets everywhere, right, no matter what chunk you choose.
Yes,
and
yes.
So
your way of talking about local and global is perfectly correct, but it's specific of differential geometry. my way of talking is more much more abstract. It goes much this the differential geometry with atlases and good gluing of the difference coordinates and things like that. It's a way of going in one surface, for example, from local information in the surface to global information in the surface. That's completely correct, and it's a perspective which is very interesting. This is a more general way of looking at things. This goes beyond differential geometry, and the differential geometry is a special case of this perspective. Okay? Let me continue with this perspective for a while. Yes.
Yeah, can I just say, I think what might be confusing the issue is you seem to suggest that going from the local to the global is like you're going from something simpler to something more complicated. And I think your intuition, I think this is what you're saying, is there's a way to think of the sheet as moving from something simpler, right? You're moving to algebraic information, you're replacing a neighborhood with some group of some sort, right? And the global information is telling you groups are patched together. So I think you're just putting it in different ways. I feel what's dangerous with your metaphor might be that what's upstairs is not actually more complicated than what's downstairs.
I think I was saying exactly the opposite. I was saying that when you go upstairs, things are simpler, smoother, and you can unite things that you have not united, you have separated here. Things are separated in the bottom, in the Manhattan grid, and when you go to the high line, they are united. In that sense, it's simpler. It's much simpler.
I agree. Okay. I thought maybe there wasn't really a misunderstanding.
I think just my only point is that, right, when you say you're getting global information by patching things together as a machine, right? You're getting your global information is about what's downstairs. It's not about the sheaf, right? The sheaf is just an ancillary structure that's there to tell you, right, to help you put together something like something like a vector field or whatever on the original object, right? The way that you were talking about made it sound as if when you pass to something like sheaf, right, that you are sort of entering this, right, what you get, the connection between what you get in this sheaf and what you get about your object wasn't made clear. So
I have to say that the sheaf is everything, you know? The sheaf is not this or this. The sheaf is the whole thing. This is the sheaf. By definition, a sheaf is two topological spaces. One on the top, which is projected on the bottom, but by something that we describe the local on the margin, so that in this point here, you can have more neighborhood which looks exactly at the same here. That is a shift. Very simple. There's not complicated things. Shift is very simple object. Do not want to. I will not accept that shift is complicated. Shift is the simplest possible object to talk about local versus global. Let me give another simple object which does that. Certainly not a differential surface. Certainly not. Much more simpler. But we will go on. So sheaves come in the 50s in the French mathematical school. And what did Grothendieck in this amazing paper, this is a 100-page paper about the foundations of homological algebra, is to find out the most general categorical structures where you can reconstruct homology. This is another extremely simple and very, very basic idea. I want to stress this for the non-mathematicians. For those who are mathematicians, I will not insist on that, but for those who are not mathematicians, a very, very simple idea which comes from Valéry. You have this opposition between continuity and discrete. You have a topological space on the side of continuity. So you want to understand the topological space. How would you do? You will produce discrete objects, which in some sense will try to capture the continuous topological space at the beginning. So Poincaré had a double strategy, which is very, very interesting, very, very important. Take the topological space. First, do the simplest thing in mathematics, linearize. Cover the topological space by triangles. Do a good composition between triangles. That gives you a structure which is the simplest structure in mathematics, which is the structure of group. Okay. You take the group of all triangulations of the space that is called the homologs. 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 Poincaré, 1895. Poincaré, in that same article, which is something extraordinary, the Institute for Poincaré, invented also another way of introducing a discrete object to capture the topological space at the beginning. Instead of covering the space by triangulations, try to look at the circles, at the closed paths in the space, and see how the closed paths in the space are transformed. I have look at the transits between the closed paths in the space and see how they behave. That gives you also a group, which is called the homology. But you have two ways of looking to a topological continuous space through very good discrete objects, the homology group or the homology group. The homology group. Homology group and it gives you a lot of information about the space. And there is the question also from Pankari, if the homology group will capture the original space or not. That is, if you have two groups which are isomorphic here and in the discrete, then the topological spaces are also homomorphic in the continuous sense at the beginning. If they capture completely the structure. There comes the famous Poincaré conjecture that perhaps you have heard also in the news, also many years ago. It was open for 100 years and it was solved, I was 10 years ago. I was an extraordinary mathematician, which is like an example for all of us, a wonderful mathematician which rejected $1 million for the solution. So it's like a sample of the great mind, which is not at all interested by economic considerations, but only the development of the human mind. So the Poincaré conjecture, what says? If you have the sphere, our usual sphere, in the global and in the Earth, that's a sphere in three dimensions. You can put that sphere instead in three dimensions in four dimensions, making a sphere in four dimensions. So the question of Poincaré was, is that sphere in four dimensions captured completely by the homology group? He thought that it was, but then he found a counterexample and he showed that no, it's not captured by the homology. Is it captured by the homotopy group? The question was open many years and the conjecture was solved not so many years ago. So these are deep, important technical problems with a lot of strong, delicate mathematics behind. But the idea of the beginning is very simple. How do you construct the discrete structure that maybe will capture the continuous? The homology was one of the great ideas. So what did Grothendieck in this article, in the Tohoku article in 1955? The article was published in 1957, but he did it in Kansas in 1955. He showed that the homology of a space is also an apparent construction. There is something more fundamental behind the homology. There is an archetype behind the homology which can be projected on the homology, and the homology can be reconstructed from an archetype. That archetype is what is called the group of K theory that Grothendieck invented in that famous article. No, a little later. So let's stay here. What I was thinking is in the next article, what Grothendieck did in the Tohoku is to reconstruct the homology from an archetype, and that archetype is not the K-theory, it's an archetype which is constructed by like mimicking some constructions in module theory. I will not talk about this technically here now, we can stand afterwards if you want the question. But then, what he discovered is that there is some archetype which can reconstruct the homology. And that archetype can be completely axiomatized. These are the abelian categories that Grothendieck introduced in that article. And in the history of category theory, it is clear in 1957 the place where you can see the category theory really becoming an important part of mathematics. Even Maclean, who was the inventor of category theory, said the point of inflection where category theory began to become a very important part of mathematics is the topoi. What he did 2 years later is what I was talking here. It's another very important, very simple idea coming from Riemann. Very important, strong idea. How will you understand the surface? The surface is that our guess I was talking. There are, in Riemann's sense, two simple ways. One is to look internally at the surface and to look the invariants in the surface which capture the surface. For example, if you have a sphere, you look at all the closed circles, maximal circles, on the sphere. With one of them, you separate the sphere into two. But if you take the donut and you take closed maximal circles, if you take one of them, you will not cut the sphere into two. Need two of them to put the donut into pieces. So in the sphere, you have with one maximal circle, you can separate the surface. With the donut, you need two of them to separate the surface, etc. In general, when you have a surface, the genus of the surface, which is an invariant geometry, so it's an invariant of the geometry, is the maximal number of maximal circles which will separate the surface into except one. Say you have the sphere with one cut, you separate it, so the genus is 1 minus 1, 0. You have the donut, you need two circles to cut it into pieces, so the genus is 2 minus 1, 1, etc. Okay? So in general, when you have a surface, then you have an invariant, which is an invariant internal to the surface, which is the genus, and which is very simple. It's the maximal number of cuts in which you will separate your surface. What Riemann found, which is called the Riemann-Roch theorem, is a very, very important theorem of 19th century, the beginning of a lot of wonderful mathematics, is that this invariant, this internal invariant, can be captured externally. Something which will be very interesting for Gottlieb, you see. Internal, external, and so on. So Riemann, what did Riemann discover? Something wonderful. You take the surface, and you take on the surface all the good functions, all the nice functions defined on the surface. These are called the analytic functions or the holomorphic functions. You take all of them, and you put all of them in a bag. That gives you, it's a name which is probably familiar for all of you, even if you're not mathematicians, a vector space. The vector space of all the holomorphic functions, find on the surface. That makes a dimension. But you also take on the surface all the bad functions, not the good ones, but the bad ones. These are called the meromorphic functions, where you have singularities. And you take the dimension. You take the difference of the two dimensions, that gives you the more or less with one constant around. That is something absolutely extraordinary. That gives you the geometry of the space, a continuous invariant obtained through an algebraic invariant an harmonization of an algebraic invariant. The difference between the dimensions of the space is like a harmony. There is a harmony between the good and the bad. That harmony gives you the genus. Something absolutely fascinating is one of the greatest theorems in all the history of mathematics. Grothendieck generalized that. Grothendieck generalized that theorem and showed that this theorem, which already is completely amazing, is a particular case of an archetype, of an archetypical theorem, which projects on the Riemann-Roch theorem. This archetype is what I was talking about, the introduction of the group of the K-theory. The K-theory is also very, very simple, but extremely simple idea. Let's go back a little to the sheaves. Take the sheaves. When you have a sheaf, you have this topological space on the top, this topological space on the bottom. The back and forth is the main idea. Glue the localities and try to get a global section. That will be one of the main problems. What part of the information is this line here? On one point, this line is projected on this point. This is called the fiber. The fiber on that point. This is why this is called the sheaf. Take a sheaf of wheat, put them together. These are the fibers. The fiber may or may not have additional information. And the going back and forth between the fibers may or may not have additional information. If you take on the fibers the simplest and the right information, and if you take in the back and forth the simplest and the right information, you will have some kind of sheaves. These are called the coherent sheaves of set, which are the simplest one in the sense that the fibers are generated by simple objects, not much of them, finite type of objects. And the going back and forth with the morphism of fibers, you get the tenants, the kernels will have finite dimension. We have finite dimension here, coherent sheaves. Those would be the simplest possible algebraic sheaves, the coherent sheaves. Invention by Serre, Champion Serre, the great mathematician, Fernando Zalamea in the 50s. They had a very beautiful correspondence that we published some years ago. Very interesting. Mathematical correspondence of two genius working on the invention of the mathematical concepts. It's very interesting for us who are interested in how mathematics is created, what is the creativity in the mathematics, how it comes, how it is changed, etc. The correspondence is very beautiful. So if you take the coherent sheaves and the simplest thing produced by them, which is a group, a group in which you don't put any information, it's called the free group. You take the free group of coherent sheaves, that's the group of K-theory. What Grothendieck discovered, amazingly, is that this seemingly very abstract concept takes the information of the Riemann-Roch theory. So what Grothendieck discovers there is that magnitude and number, magnitude is the genus of the solvers, some invariant associated to continuity, and the harmonic difference between the dimensions is a number, that those are particular cases of general concept. This is the Riemann-Roch. Well, let's continue. That was sheaves. Okay. The beginning of sheaves. We will come back on sheaves several times. And we will have opportunity with the questions and everything. Little by little, this figure should be very, very easy for you to grasp. figure would be the potential difference. So the second generalization is the notion of schema, which shifts with the theory of shifts and the categories of shifts, the categories of coherent shifts. Grothendieck showed that homology was a particular case of a general machinery. General machinery were the category, the Abelian categories, and the Abelian categories were the axiomatization of the categories of coherent shifts. That's it. Not very hard concept. So let's continue. Again, the fight between discrete and continuous. There is the fight. That's the essential fight for mathematics. Because the essential fight for mathematics has taken centuries, and we are focusing on the mathematics which were developed from Riemann and Galois on to solve part of this basic dialectics. So on the left you have Riemann with what I told a moment ago. To understand the curve, you take all the information on the curve, the outside information of the curve, or Galois, to understand an algebraic equation, you take all the possible information between the bottom equation and the solutions, you extend that, and then you have an important algebraic theory linked to maximal ideas. What is that? I have talked about multiple functions already. What is that thing about maximal ideas? So, let's see. Let's take the simplest structure for us, the integers. See, with multiplication and summation, okay, addition and summation. That is a ring. You generalize that for an algebraic structure which behaves well with the properties of a group and a good distribution of multiplication and summation, and then you get a general ring. There are a lot of rings which are not the simplest one. See, sum and multiplication. These general rings can provide a lot of algebraic and arithmetic information, which is not trivial at all. For example, you can take rings which are finite rings, not infinite rings, but finite rings, and those finite rings can get a lot of arithmetical specific information that the infinite rings lose in some sense. So, think in a general structure in which you have addition and multiplication with two or three axioms which show that the structure behaves well, and then you try to generalize the idea of an atom, of a point. Instead of having a point, you try to generalize the idea. The point is the thing in mathematics which has nothing between them and nothingness. In arithmetic, when you think about objects in mathematics in which you have nothing between them and the simplest number, which is one, there is no number between them in the sense of multiplication. For example, between 1 and 2, there is no number which is in the middle dividing 2. Between 1 and 3, there is no number in the middle between them dividing 3. No, it doesn't happen with 4. With 4, between 1 and 4, you have one number in the middle, which is 2. You divide 4 and it multiplies 1, etc. This is clear for you that you get in the first line of the prime numbers. By definition, a number is prime if it doesn't have a division of himself and 1. So atoms, in the sense of arithmetic, are prime numbers. If you generalize a little that, you take prime ideas. Prime ideas in general commutative rings are the generalizations of the atoms that we work about usually. Something interesting happens here. If you take, for example, the integers with sum and multiplication, and you take all the prime ideals, and you put it, imagine that you have here a discrete object, and you try to put some continuity in there. You try to put like a simple topology on there. If you try if you put the simplest topology on the set of prime ideals, then you get a very interesting object which is non-separated. The usual objects are separated. But if on the integers you state the prime ideas, it is called the spectrum of the ring. In the spectrum of the ring, you put a simple topology, that topology will not be separated. For example, the closure of zero will be the whole space. Things interesting appear there. So what he did was to generalize the ring of meromorphic functions of Riemann, the rings of Galois and Dedekind, to an arbitrary general situation. And in that arbitrary general situation, non-separated objects appear in a natural way. These some examples, some particular cases of those will be the schemes. Schemes of Grothendieck will be what? A scheme will be a kind of sheaf. This is a scheme will be a sheaf where this thing is what is called a local ring, and in that local ring we will have the basic algebraic information. That's a scheme. Where in the bottom you have the prime ideals. So you take an arbitrary, you take the prime ideas here, they work as points, and on any point you take the fiber as the local ring generated by the prime ideas. So a scheme will be a sheaf with more information on the fiber. So if you are not happy with my metaphor of the high line, I will continue with that again. Yeah. The high line also can be some sort of a scheme. Why? Because beyond the basic idea of the Manhattan grid and the high line, which is connecting with different lower sections, the information, the separated information here comes in here, continuous workload information. What you have to do is to change the topology in the bottom part. Instead of working with points which are given by being in the half third of between the 13th and the 14th street and this avenue, you will have a grid, a separated grid. Instead of working with those, which will be the points, you have to think about something which we generalize that, which should be the metaphor of the prime ideas. So you should have some sort of topology. Some sort of topology will be given now by neighborhoods, more close to what we were saying at the beginning. You will have now neighborhoods, small neighborhoods around the points, and on that topology you will take the sheaves on those neighborhoods. You will need more information. You will not need only how to walk around the high line, how to take this balcony, or how to go beyond that tree which is below you, or that grid of flowers, but you will need more information on the fibers. Those informations of the fibers could be, why not imagine them, good buildings. Interesting buildings that are on the high line. On those buildings, you have good information, good additional information that says, that explains you how to glue all the different parts on the high line. So you have to do two things to have this metaphor work. You have to change the Cartesian grid by a topological neighborhood grid, and then take beyond our persons the buildings, which are the fibers with local information. Of course, this is a method. The mathematics is independent of the method. This is a very interesting place to begin to read his conference of 1958 in the International Mathematical Congress. It's a very, very amazing conference in which there are like 50 pages. The first 3 pages are wonderful, completely understandable by everyone, in which he explains what he will be doing in mathematics in the next 10 years. And he explains how his program is, in fact, an intersection of Galois and Riemann, and how he will, in some sense, discover what is common to number and magnitude, what is common to topology and algebra, what is common to continuity and discrete. It's a wonderful idea. He did most of this program with another of his great friends, Jean Dieudonné. Jean Dieudonné and Jean-Pierre Serre are the great, two great mathematical colleagues of Grothendieck. Without them, he would have had a lot of problems to develop the mathematics. In particular, Dieudonné, which was a very important Bourbaki member, very much more aged than Grothendieck, was very generous, and he put all of his strength to write down all Grothendieck's ideas. So this is a gigantic monument with at least 1,500 pages, in which Dieudonné wrote every day all the Grothendieck's ideas that he was thinking in the night, and they put them together in a very beautiful and in general, very seldom read. Grothendieck is a little known about, but it's very, very little read. It should be read a lot more. These are things that I will, I have not much time, we will come back to this afterwards. General idea, I have talked about this general idea, an archetype which is projected in several types around the world. We come to the third general basic idea, the topos. The topos idea is a generalization of the space. Go beyond the space, our usual space. I will go very quickly. Our usual space is separated and classical, at least how we think about it. Is separated by grids, classical, it's not plastic enough, it's not continuous enough in the general abstraction. What Grothendieck discovered is that if you take the collection of all sheaves, not one sheaf, but the collection of all sheaves together, this gives you a notion or a new notion of geometry, an extended geometry. It is called the topos. Topos is by definition a category of sheaves. Then, when you take the category of all sheaves, you get the topos, then you get a new geometry, and with the new geometry, you get new logics. For example, you can have actions of a structure on the world. If the structure is a group, and you have those actions on the world, all these are theorems, mathematical theorems. You take the actions of a group. It has an intrinsic logic, which is classical, in which things are B or not B, B or not B. Instead, we know that the world shouldn't be like that. The usual actions shouldn't be actions by groups, but actions where you have a generalized structure, which is called the monoid, in which you don't have inverses. The logic of monoid actions is not classical, it's intuitionistic. It's topological, it's plastic. These are things that Grothendieck and his school discovered afterwards. So if you take the sheaves and you extend to the category of all sheaves and you look at the structure, then you get new geometries, new logics. This comes from his PhD thesis. I will go over this slide. You can look at them if you're interested. The ideas come from back behind in England from the 1960s. His PhD thesis was between 1949 and 1953. And already many mathematical ideas are already particular. Some of these ideas of looking at the categories of four geometrical structures. He looked there at the categories of the geometry of analytical spaces, what is called, what I call the Banach and the Hilbert space. So the basic idea about topoi is this: take the sheaves, the category of four sheaves, you get then new objects and the logic changes. The fourth general idea, models. So I will come back for each of these afterwards. When we will have an application of sheaves to culture, I will come back to sheaves. When we will have applications of schemes to culture, I will come back to schemes. When we will have applications from topos to culture, I will come back to topos, etc. Okay? The fourth idea are the motifs. The motifs are looking again in a very Grothendieckian way, to the archetypes. You have your object, your continuous object, and you have a way to cover the objects with simplicial objects, with triangulated objects, triangles. There are a lot of ways to do that. That gives you a lot of homologies. If you have one object, a lot of homologies. There is a multiplicity of homologies. Grothendieck, his way thinks, this multiplicity of homologies is just apparent. There should be a root, a common root. There should be an archetype which reconstructs all the homologies. These are the motifs. Okay. So, Grothendieck conjectures in the thesis that behind a lot of homologies and cohomologies, homologies is one way of looking at the rows. Cohomologies is one way to look at the rows in the other side, in the other sense. When you do the change, some constructions simplify. So in general, the cohomology is simpler than the homology. And this is why we work in general with cohomologies. So you have a lot of cohomologies. What is the common root to all of them? The conjecture that there were mathematical simple objects which help to reconstruct all the different cohomologies, all the different forms. This is still an open field of inquiry. He conjectured the existence of these objects in the 60s, and only in 2000, Vladimir Vygotsky, one of the few methods, gave the explicit mathematical construction that showed that it worked. So the motifs, you can see there, do not distribute. These were very conjectural in one moment. Grothendieck was very keen to show his work in that moment. He wanted to be a little retracted from the community already there. And this went to underground. It's like underground mathematics for many years until Vygotsky 2000 gave it mathematical correctness. The motifs were for him like a musical trend. You have like different variations, and between the different variations, there should be some common grounds, some themes. These themes should be projected in the different variations. So there is a musical harmony between theme and variations that you want to reconstruct between the different homologies and variations of a common theme, common motif. He was saying, Grothendieck always said, we have to listen. We have to listen at things. Things are there and they speak to us. We are not intelligent enough to hear. But if we hear well, then things will speak to us. And the only thing that we will do is to make that sound be available for the So I will finish here. So we have at least 10 minutes to if you have some more questions. But we will develop all of this afterwards. Okay? Don't worry if I have been perhaps too much mathematical for the non-mathematicians and too little mathematics for the mathematicians. I know about that. But we will come again on this on these main questions. Here are the four basic master. The arena categories, the study of ships, study of ships in general, and in particular the ships of avenues between the arena. It's in the study of the transits in general. Then you have the schemes. In the schemes, you have sheaves over generalization of numbers. Generalizations of numbers are the prime spectrum. You shouldn't worry too much now. You know what is the generalization of the integers. The prime spectrum is the set of prime ideas, generalization of an atom, the bond, and then you take sheaves over that, that gives you a generalization of numbers. Then you take sheaves over general topologies. This is a thing that I didn't speak too much. You have two ways of looking at the topology is given by information, local information about the point, so the neighborhoods are the point. Or instead of covering the point by neighborhoods, you could try to get information on the point with the arrows, information, paths, different paths of information. For example, if you're in you have one path if you go from one point to the other, you have one path if you go to the point six or the other, or if you go to the building or whatever you want to do, you have different paths. If the paths work together with some hereditary constructions, a path of the path is a path, and things like that, if you cover points with paths and each of these is covered by paths, then the point thing is a covering. This is called the Grothendieck topology. Looking at topology or an analytical by points or by the Grothendieck transformation of the analytical way of understanding locality, not by points but by information, relational information which comes to the point. These are called the Grothendieck topology. So we make shifts over Grothendieck topology in general and in the topos. The particular cases are the ones that I was telling you. Then shifts, we will give you topos. And then the space will have an internal geometry, which is not the usual one, but the geometry changes. And the change of geometry gives you a change of geometry. Motives should be shifts over something. We don't know yet what it is. It's something that is being studied around what are the common grounds for the sheaves in order to make the models. This is yet conjecture, this is mathematics. But in fact, you have the basic objects of mathematics: number, magnitude, discreteness, continuity, and form. These are the basic questions of mathematics. What is interesting is that gives new understanding of each of them, each of these constructions, coming all of them from the basic idea of shift. And if shift is transient, then we are, and this is what Grothendieck did, he is reconstructing all mathematical basic ideas from the notion of class. This is something which should be important for our culture. We will see if we, that is true in my talks, but part of it should be. So, sorry about the time. I told you that I was going to stand a little bit more, but we have still 5 minutes if you want to.
Can you tell what is that URL for?
What is that?
What is the URL where we can get the PDF of the lecture?
Ah, yes, please.
Oh, yes, that's please. Zalamea Seminar, New York City, well, NYC.
This is all one word?
One word, Zalamea Seminar, NYC. .wordpress.com.
And that's the lecture as well as the live stream?
The live stream is at New Center.
NEW?
Yes. New Center, I believe it's .org. If you just look for New Center for Research and Practice on the internet, you can get that. You just Google it.
Yeah,
that's
TRG.
Yeah.
So this slide will be available this night sometimes. Yes, please.
Is it, would it be fair to say that transits are about moving between different levels of abstraction?
That is one way. And there are, if you go, for example, here to this basic slide. This is really the basic slide. The basic figure is this one. In this one, you can see here both abstraction and particularity, generality and differentiation and integration. You have the multiple and the one. So the transits are in this way back and forth between abstraction and particularity. But also very important. There is the horizontal transit. The horizontal transit is for us the most important one in the sense from one quarter to the other. If you have one neighborhood here, section, one section around, then you change the neighborhood, another more section, change the neighborhood, another second section. You are asked to see if there is some common ground, some path. Between the different local sections. This is a horizontal transit. Going from the local to the global in the sheaves is a horizontal transit.
So by calling those things the same name, you're saying there's somehow the same concept?
Excuse me?
So like it's up and down movement similar to yes being in terms of abstraction. But then, like, once we get into a higher level, like, also the connection between things that constitutes abstraction is also called a transit.
Yes. You have a back and forth transit between, say, the bottom and the top topological space, the fibers, projections, and then you have the horizontal transit. In which you are asked to see if the different localities are well. When you can do together, then you pass from local sections to perhaps a global section.
Okay. And is that like a category?
No.
Okay.
The category is to take all of these together.
Okay.
This is one of them. One shift. Take all the shifts together. That's
okay.
And that
category. So, in a technical sense, do you mean by the horizontal transits, are you referring to an open cover or to a natural transformation between sheaves? Or is it neither of those two?
No. Here we have just the open cover here. And the open cover is reflected here to the gluing of sections. What you are talking about, the natural transformations, will be between one of these and another, see what happens between them.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Can you give some kind of a definition of what you mean by a transit?
Not yet. I hope not to give one, because if I give it a definition, it will finish with all the general applications. But the transit should be something which is very simple in the following sense. Perhaps I will be patient here. But I don't want to give it a definition, because it will finish any possible application afterwards. By transit will be something like this, a mediation. We are in a graduate program in industry. Mediation. A mediation between one and two. So if you have one object and another object, there is often, not always, but often there is a mediation. Between one and two, there is a third. For Peirce, this is like the basic object of thought. The basic object of thought is the relations between objects. The relations between objects are mediations. Our transits should be those kinds of mediations. If you want to give some sort of definition, then it would be like an incarnation of Peirce terminus. But what is the sense? No sense for the definition.
And how do you integrate situations like transit mediation? So I figured it out. So, yeah. The notion of contamination.
Contamination. We will speak about contamination afterwards. Let me come back afterwards to that. It will be important for us. It will be important for us in the sense that we will be hoping to finish with the good separation properties. If we think that we have things well separated, then they are not contaminated. We are hoping to contaminate, so in that sense. We are hoping that there will be enough transits, that person learned sense perhaps, in which the apparent difference and the apparent distances are not so. But there should be a contamination everywhere. So, general, to answer your ideas, we will be looking for a philosophy of contamination. Yes. It has been done. A lot of it has been done. We will talk about that. But I think that the Grothendieck's ideas provide new perspectives for the general
philosophy. To what extent is this
related
to the tower of hierarchy? And is there any limit to it?
No, there is no limit. By the mathematical constructions, again, in some moment, demonstrated, proved in mathematics that when you have a context, a mathematical, well-defined concept with axioms, and this context already is powerful enough to have arithmetic inside it, then there will be a tower of constructions which never ends. So never it never ends. It's related with what we're saying in a moment. After Gödel, there is no possibility of an absolute in mathematics. So there is a tower of ever-growing constructions, yes. And one level explains better the layer before, yes. That happens a lot. When you go to an abstract layer, it explains better the particularities which were here, but this is not enough to explain himself, and then you got to go over and over.
So, how is it fundamental?
Fundamental in what sense?
Well, you said that the projections are something specific from something more fundamental. The more fundamental thing is always higher and higher, right? So, it's not.
There is no fight.
Fundamental, right?
There is no usual foundation. The usual analytical foundation is there is no ultimate foundation. There will be no absolute foundation. But there is a simpler object which is projected in concepts which were very important for mathematics. The most important concepts for mathematics were clearly those ones internet, you are making that your number.
Are you claiming that the higher the tower, the smoother the idea?
No, I'm not saying that. No, it's easily explained. The layer below. Here, our damn thing is the sheaf. The sheaf concept will explain both number. This is the generalization. It's the going upper idea. What is the foundation for sheaves? There are a lot of possibilities. In this moment, in fact, here in America, there is a very interesting group in principle, which is taking very seriously ideas, and which is trying to produce the third foundation for mathematics since the beginning of the 20th century. The first one was set theory. Analytical method to understand the object by its elements, absent for set theory. Then category theory, following Grothendieck, to understand the object to its relationships. And there is now a third one, very, very interesting one by the Wolski and Richardson. It is called the homotopy type theory. Homotopy type theory. Homotopy type theory. Code H O T E, homotopy type theory. They are doing wonderful work. It's still in the making. We don't know very well when it is going to end. But they are trying to get new foundations of mathematics, taking the sheaves as the basic concept.
How does the idea of dimension relate to this? How does the idea of dimension relate to this?
Dimension? Dimension in the Riemann graph, for example. We have the dimension coming inside the Riemann graph theorem. The difference of dimensions between the spectrum of morphisms and the capture the genus in that sense.
I'm trying to understand what gluing is.
And gluing is patching together when you have coherent information. You may have not coherent.
Is it kind of a map?
Kind of?
Is it a map?
But no, it's just going to it. Do it. You have this one, and you do this. Yes.
Okay. Okay. So it's kind of like composition.
So maybe. If you think that it's like you have like coordinates from here, like you want to hatch together these coordinates.
It's patching. The patching will do it.
We'll talk about.
Yeah, we're just wondering, in terms of the sheaf concept, it seems like only the vertical transits are spoken of as fibers, not the horizontal ones.
The fibers are this one. When we speak about fibers, these are the fibers. And then the going back and forth is between a point and the fiber. But afterward, when I was saying the important information in the sheaf is how the different local sections are patched together, are grouped together in a perhaps global one. And that one is in the center. Okay? You have this one here, another one here, another one, you move them together, and you patch them together in a single walk, and you walk them together. So that's the number of the high line. You can walk together something that on the bottom space you cannot do. I don't know if it's a good metaphor, but I was saying it was true. Any questions?
Really quick. You said that homology results from covering a space with triangles, getting the triangularizations.
Yeah.
And then homopathy? I just missed that.
Homotopy is you have your space. Let's take a sphere. You cover it by triangles, and then you get the usual maps, the projections, the usual maps that we live on. But you can also do, you can take closed paths. You can take a closed path on the surface, a small one or a big one. If you take the big one, maximal ones, then you look how much of this do you need in order to separate the rock. In order if you get the sphere and you take the equator and you separate the sphere along the equator, then you get the north and the south. to different parts. So in general, in a surface in general, you look at all the closed circles, maximal closed circles, with which you can separate your objects. You take your donut, then you will need more than one. With one cut, your donut is still in one piece, but with two cuts, it's in two pieces. So that's the homotopy.
What's the relationship between globals and topology?
There are a lot of relationships. Topos is like a very abstract and generalized notion of topology. The first one is that sheaves comes from the topology. A sheaf, by definition, is one topological space, another topological space, and the back and forth between them, with the essential question when the locals will be grouped in a group. So you have the topology already in a sheaf, by definition. Is a set of two topological spaces with a back and forth to answer when the local will be patched together into the world. You make the category of four chips, that's it. The category of four chips is top. So you have already the idea coming from one, and the notions of oneness, the topology. And if you put all of them together, then you get. Multiplicity of topology, one which they are there. The other one is the one in which I was saying that topology can be understood in two ways. Topology can be understood analytically, covering the point with neighborhoods, or synthetically, covering the point by paths. The second one is they are extremely related. What will be nice is that the topos in general will not be separated. The logic will be much more interesting. The classical logic is basically trivial. Things are arrogant. So we are not to be said the logical question is completely uninteresting. Things are black or white, certainly not in the world, things are not black or white. There are a lot of very interesting colors in the middle. Okay. The logic of the real world is certainly not classical. So the logic of geometry should not be classical. And what happens with the topos is that theoretically, that is the case. Theoretically, the logic of the topoi will not be classical. And there is another more, there are a lot of connections. There is another connection very powerful. Because the natural models for classical logic, you remember, are just Boolean algebras, separated objects, sets of parts of one set. Instead, the natural models for the impressionistic logic are the topological spaces. The topological spaces are the ones which are the natural model for. So if the logic of the point is impressionistic, then we are on the right way. We will be coming on the several times.
I'm not sure if I can word this well, but are there any problems with assumptions maybe about kind of a Boolean logic or an on-off logic as you're constructing these topos? In an attempt to create an intuitionistic logic, like is there any type of like, I don't know if circularity is the right word, but like it seems like we're making mathematical and on-off assumptions to construct this topos. So is there any type of limiting or anything like that that's happening?
No, there is no problem. You can do that with an intuitionistic language, and you can develop the topos theory in over an intuitionistic language, and it works very well. But if you do it on a classical language, it's not the problem neither, because you take the classical language and the models are not classical. So it's not, mathematically, it will not be a problem, because we will be mathematically interested in those topological models which are not classical. Do not worry about them. If you are interested more in the foundations type or looking for a completely consistent way of developing the theory, you can do it also. Take an intuitionistic language, develop topos theory or an intuitionistic language, it goes well ahead. It doesn't go so much ahead as to get, for example, which is very typical of set theory, which has the large cardinal, like that. Things large in set theory cannot be well captured with these ideas. But it doesn't, it's not to worry much about, because those large cardinals, in fact, for the moment, have very little application. Thank you very much for your assistance. Thank you.